Rob McConnell's Boss Brass, which originally was just brass, and then flowered on into the full-size ensemble that you see on stage right now. Charlie Ferguson has been a long-time figure at our events. You mostly have seen him playing the piano, as you know, a brilliant piano player. You've heard his arrangements with some of the various bands, the Kenton Legacy Orchestra, and other bands that have performed here at the festival. Charlie has always been a huge fan of the Rob McConnell Band. And I don't know, a couple years ago, you know, Charlie, as you've heard, brilliant piano player, right? Charlie decided he wanted, you know, that he wanted to play the Boss Brass music and just kind of flippantly said one day, yeah, I'm starting to play the valve trombone so I can do the Rob McConnell music. And, you know, masters that in about 6 weeks, and here we are. So he is quite amazing, and I think you'll, if you're a fan of the Boss Brass, you're going to love the concert today. So we'll leave the lights up a little bit while you're eating, and then we'll lower them as we go along. But, you know, grab all you want from the buffet, enjoy yourself, and please welcome Charlie Ferguson and our celebration of Rob McConnell's Boss Brass.
Well, that was all very nice. Thank you, Ken. Before we begin, I'd like to dedicate this concert to two wonderful people that we unfortunately lost while we were in preparation for this concert. The first one was actually a valued member of this band for many years playing bass, and a legendary figure originally from Toronto, and actually moved to California about 30 years ago, and he was very, very much loved by everyone in the band, my best friend in the world, and he was also played here at many of the concerts for the Institute, and we lost him recently to cancer, and we miss him every day. Chris Connor. The second person actually was another legendary Toronto jazz figure, one of three people to have served in the Boss Brass for the entire 30-year existence of the band, a very prized figure in the jazz community at large, playing with not only the Boss Brass, but also Paul Desmond, and Dave McKenna, and Scott Hamilton, and Milt Jackson, and without question, one of the greatest guitarists that Canada has ever produced, Ed Bickert. Both of these gentlemen deserve so many more words than I can say about them right now. But I think the most appropriate thing to do is just to play some music for all of you. So here it is, and we hope you enjoy it. Thank you. No. So as you probably already figured out, that was Just Friends, one of the all-time classic Rob McConnell arrangements. And on the solo, you heard from myself on valve trombone, Gene Burkert. All right, there's one. I knew somebody liked this nightmare of an instrument. We also had Gene Burkert on the tenor saxophone solo. And on the trumpet solo, who drove all the way up here from San Diego to do this gig, you freaking maniac. Brad Steinwehe. So, actually a common occurrence in the trumpet section for some reason, I don't know why, but Chuck Howe on the end came from Santa Rosa last night. And sometimes Papenbrook comes from New Zealand. But anyway. So this is the Charlie Ferguson Big Band. I'm Charlie Ferguson, and we are celebrating the music of Rob McConnell and the Boss Brass, one of the all-time great arrangers and band leaders from Toronto, Canada. The Boss Brass, as Ken mentioned, actually started in 1968 as a pop covers band for the Canadian Talent Library. And if you don't know what that was, essentially it was Canada's way of promoting music from their, made by their own people. So, and it could be anything. It didn't matter what kind of music it was. It could be easy listening, it could be jazz, it could be country, it could be serious orchestral works. But it was a fun experiment for about 20 years. And so when Rob put the band together for this company, he actually, it was different from the band that we know today in two very specific ways. Number one is that instead of a jazz band, it was a pop covers band, meaning that they did tunes, you know, chart hits of the time like Mrs. Robinson and God Didn't Make Little Green Apples and all these tunes from the Beatles and Burt Bacharach and putting, using them with something approaching jazz chords. And the other way that it was different was that it was purely a brass band. It was called the Boss Brass for that reason. It was four trumpets, four trombones, three French horns, no saxophones, and a pop rhythm section with two guitars and Fender bass and no piano. But it was, it worked for a while. They made their first three albums that way from 1968 to 1970 in that configuration. And then one night when they were, when the Boss Brass was playing a gig at the Saverin nightclub in Toronto, a lot of the top Toronto saxophone players like Mo Kaufman and Jerry Toth and Phil Nimmons actually came into the club and started protesting. Like they had picket signs that said, Boss Brass unfair to saxophone players, and that kind of thing. And so that was a very amusing publicity stunt. But it was also the turning point for Rob, and he decided, okay, enough of this falderal, let's make this into a real jazz band. And so he added the saxophone section, got rid of one of the French horn players, got rid of one of the guitar players, and added a piano player. And so they went on, they started playing more jazz-oriented material, at least live. You know, when they were recording albums, they still had to do the pop stuff. This next chart that we're going to do actually comes from, it is the lead-off track on the very first album that the Boss Brass made with saxophones, On a Cool Day, from 1971. And it's one that you never really hear anymore, if you ever did. They may have played it live once or twice, I don't know. But this is a tune, another one of the pop tunes, originally by Joe South, made famous by Lynn Anderson. This is called I Never Promise You a Rose Garden.
Don't worry, it's not what
you think.
One, two, three.
Thank you very much. That was good. At this point, you're probably asking yourself, why does a band from California have all this music from Canada? Now, the answer is very simple. My grandfather, Alan Ferguson, who some of you probably know as a very esteemed composer. Okay, there's one. Rob and my grandfather were friends for many, many years. Rob and my grandfather and my father, Dan Ferguson, who's playing guitar with us today, they all talked together. So he's partly to blame for this. But anyway, all three of those people taught together at the Dick Grove School of Music from about 1988 to 89. Rob moved out here for a while, broke up the Boss Brass and moved out here, and got some gigs teaching and playing out with Bob Florence and Frank Capp and different kinds of people. And in addition to that, he also had a student band at Grove. So many, many people were witness to his unique personality. And the amazing thing is, when Rob moved back to Canada in the early 90s and got the Boss Brass together again, he actually, you know, left behind many of his charts for the Boss Brass, photocopies and stuff, so that was awfully nice of him to do that, and very fortuitous for what we're doing here today. And so as a result of that, we actually have quite a bit of music that was written for the band but was never recorded, ever. And this next arrangement is one of them. Actually, I believe one of the very first arrangements ever written for the Boss Brass with the saxophone section. And I know that because it's the first one we have in numerical order. So this is a tune originally by Herbie Hancock, sort of a little bit different than what Rob normally did, but it's fun anyway. This is Tell Me a Bedtime Story. Thank you.
Ken Ferguson on guitar.
I guess I'm going to be using this mic to talk. Maybe I should have the bone over there. Yeah, makes more sense that way. So, continuing on with the history of the Boss Brass, they made their pile of dough. I'm assuming making these pop albums, and then they went to the jazz side. I almost said the dark side, but yeah. But they continued on with their making the direct-to-disc albums, which were, you know, there were two of them, and they were both double vinyl sets. So you can imagine what that did for them. But this here is a sort of the continuation of the jazz side of the Boss Brass, which we'll be sticking with for the remainder of this program. This was actually on a album called Present Perfect from 1979, the first of two albums that they made for the MPS label in Germany. And there's actually kind of a fairly amusing story behind this album that may or may not be true. I'm just going to assume it is. But this album, when it came out, actually was nominated, or actually won the Juno Award for Best Jazz Album of 1981, which, if you don't know what the Junos are, they're basically the Canadian Grammys. And the story goes that that Rob was actually conducting the orchestra in the pit when the announcement was made, and so when the presenter, Andrea Martin from SCTV, announced that Rob had won this album, Rob actually had to climb out of the orchestra pit to accept the award. Again, I have no idea if this is true or not. I can't verify it as fact, but we won't let, you know, let's not let truth get in the way of a good story, right? This then is You Took Advantage of Me.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was Greg Beck on the trumpet solo. And on tenor, man who is literally reading this book for the first time, just got it an hour ago looking at it, but he's doing a great job. Jerry Pinter. All right, so the next tune is another one from the very brief MPS period. This album was actually it's called Tribute, and it was a tribute to legendary jazz figures of that time who had recently passed away. This was in 1981, and it was all the theme for that album was it was all songs that were written by those composers like Hannibal Adderley and Bill Evans and Blue Mitchell and that kind of thing. This next tune was on that album. It's very special. It's a tune by Frank Rosolino, and you probably know the one I'm talking about. And it was kind of a special thing for the Rob and the band because one point in 1978, the summer of 1978, Phil Nimmons, who we remember from the protest story, he was teaching at the Banff Conservatory, and he had his faculty band, which basically was all pros from Toronto. It was going to be Rob and Phil on clarinet, and Ed Bickert and Don Thompson and Terry Clark, and somewhere along the way, Rob ended up not being able to make the gig, but he sent Frank Rosolino as a sub. So that was a very cool thing, and of course it was even more, you know, it meant even more because just a short time later Frank was gone. So this is Rob's tribute to Frank featuring the trombone section. This is Blue Daniel. Thank you. Thank you. That was Abdullah Ebrahim on the trombone solo. So after Rob had his spell in California, he came back to Toronto and started writing these very, very long-winded concert pieces, of which this is a fine example. If any of you saw Kim Richmond's band on Friday night, this may remind you of some of his epic works. But it just shows how much Rob loved the standards that he wanted to do anything he could with them. And so this is All the Things You Are. And I do mean all of them.
Thank you.
Wheatley on piano. One Duke Ellington tune on any gig that I do, because if I don't, it's 7 years bad luck. And I wasn't able to do that this time, but this next tune was actually written by Duke's son, Mercer Ellington. So I figure this way we're covered for another 4 years. The other, I guess the most interesting thing that I have to say about this chart is that the original recording of this actually was on a Concord compilation CD called Jazz on the 19th Hole, and I suppose the theme was tracks from the Concord catalog that were supposed to sound good coming through the speakers of a golf course clubhouse. So if we ever get to the point in our careers where we get to play at a golf course, if we by some miracle we become the next Phil Normans, then we must be prepared for any and all possibilities. This is Things Ain't What They Used to Be. Thank you. Gene Berger on tenor saxophone. Dan Ferguson on guitar. Yeah, and I forgot to mention the, almost forgot to mention the lead trumpet double A of Brad Steinwehe, who also is dressed appropriately for the occasion. You probably, some of you probably remember there was a there was an album of the Boss Brass where they were all standing on the cover. They were all standing wearing hockey jerseys that said that had names on them like Glenn Miller and Tex Beneke and Guy Lombardo and that kind of thing. We didn't have any of those on hand, but this is good for now. But by the way, I just wanted to mention how cool is it that we're doing music from Toronto right after the Toronto Raptors made the NBA Finals for the first time ever. A happy accident. So, now we've come this far, we can't leave you without a Guido feature. This is from my personal favorite Boss Brass album, our 25th year from 1993. I love this album. If I had my druthers, I'd do the entire album. But since that option is not available to us right now, we'll just go with this. And the other cool thing about this is that this chart was actually written by Rick Wilkins, who, as many of you know, is a very important figure in the Boss Brass, very important writer, played second tenor saxophone. And with respect to the other great writers for the band, like Ian McDougall and Ron Collier and Phil Nimmons and Bruce Cassidy and all those guys, Rick was the only guy that Rob ever asked to write a chart for the band. So that should tell you something. This is one of the all-time classic Guido features arranged by Rick Wilkins, featuring the workhorse of this weekend. I don't even know how many bands he's played with so far, and this probably isn't his last one. Ron Stout. And this is the Rick Wilkins chart on Imagination.
Thank you.
There's a couple more we wanted to do, but I don't know if we have time. Can we go over by maybe 10 minutes? Okay. Cool. All right, so next we'd like to show one of the other great things about Rob was he was a great composer as well as an arranger of standards and jazz tunes. And this next one actually is comes from the later period. Of course, we're doing the history of the Boss Brass. So this is a tune that actually features both of our tenor players, Gene Burkert and Jerry Pinter, and it's based off of anecdote by Al Cohn, sort of Rob's tribute to Al Cohn and Zoot Sims, but it's a reference to an Al Cohn joke that I can't recall right now, and I don't think we were able to get the proper clearance on that, were we? A nun in a car. All right, we'll go with that. This then is called This May Be Your Lucky Day.
Thank you.
Well, I suppose this is as good a time as any to introduce the band, starting with the saxophone section. On your left to your right, Gene Burkert, Glen Garrett, Mark Markus, Jerry Pinter, Bob Crosby. Behind them are the trombones, gamely blasting it out in the middle there. Fred Simmons, Abdullah, Ebrahim, Jock, Ellis, and George Thatcher. Next to the trombones, the French horns, which are of course an integral part of the Boss Brass and of this band as well. Tawnee, Lillo, and Suzette Moriarty. The trumpet section in the back, we have Ron Stout, Greg Beck, John Papenbrook, Brad Steinwehe, and Chuck Howe. The rhythm section, on guitar, Dan Ferguson. On piano, our Toronto connection, David Wheatley. Randy Landas on the bass. Ralph Razze on drums. Craig Fundiga on vibes and bells. And also seeing this book fairly recently, Bruce Carver on percussion. I thank all of you in the band, and I thank you all in the audience for being here. By showing up here today, you honor Rob and his music in a way that I cannot even express, so thank you for that. And also, the biggest thanks go to Ken Poston and Eric Fankhauser for giving us our shot here to show our respect. So, we're going to leave you now with a tune that was actually written by Gene Perling, the Singers Unlimited. Essentially, he was the Rob McConnell of vocal groups, and he and Rob had many great collaborations together. This is a tune that he actually wrote for the Singers Unlimited that Rob rescored for the Boss Brass, and so we hope that this tune sends you off into the rest of your day with a good feeling and not thinking about any negativity or anything like that. Just something nice to send you out on. This is Nightfall.
Thank you.
the band. Stand up if you can. Thank you all so much. You're a lovely audience. We'll see you next time. Thanks again.